Hello, and thank you for tuning into our podcast today, which is all about the challenge of decarbonising the UK's transport system. My name is Eddie Gibson, National Senior Account Manager for Local Government at Crown Commercial Service, and I'm joined today on the podcast by Andrew Summers, Strategic Director at Transport East, the subnational transport body for East Anglia. For some context on why decarbonising our transport system is so important, figures from the Department for Business, Energy and Industrial Strategy indicate that transport was responsible for 34% of UK carbon dioxide emissions in 2019, making it the UK's single biggest source of greenhouse gas. The good news is that transport emissions in 2019 were down 2.8% on the 2018 figures, but that still leaves us with a long way to go. After a very strange year for transport in 2020, we're starting to see a return to those pre-pandemic transport levels, and the recent fuel crisis. Queues for petrol several hours long at stations remind us just how dependent we all still are on fossil fuel transportation. So welcome, Andrew, and thanks for giving up your time today. It's much appreciated. Firstly, please tell us a little bit about Transport East and your role.
Hi, Eddie. It's great to be here on the podcast. So Transport East, we're the subnational transport body for Norfolk, Suffolk, Essex, Southend and Thurrock. So we cover the Wash in the north of the region all the way down to the Thames. Now, we're one of seven regional subnational transport bodies that collectively cover all of England outside of London. Transport East was formed in 2018. Now, at that time, our regional leaders recognised that the East really needed a single voice for transport investment. The way in which transport is delivered in the East and our needs are really different to those in London, the North and other parts of England and the UK. Our leaders wanted to really set out the East's unique challenges and the transport funding we need, and saw a real opportunity to work more closely together with each other, with our neighbours and with government, importantly. So we therefore came together as a partnership of local authorities, business leaders and other regional partners. And our role is to really increase and accelerate transport investment in the East to both meet regional and national goals. Now, that doesn't happen by accident. That all needs resource. Transport East was kicked off by the excellent work of a set of dedicated leaders and officers across the region, who continue to oversee Transport East today. You really need that resource to make it happen. So they made the case for the creation of a day-to-day team that would provide more capacity to drive Transport East forward. So that's where I come in. I joined as strategic director in April 2020, just after the first lockdown started, as the first full-time member of staff. And since then, we've grown to a small but mighty team of four people. Now, Transport East plays a number of roles and skills, and the team really reflects this. Just to explain a bit further of the diversity of the skills that we need within that team, we have to do five things, basically. Firstly, lead on strategic thinking on transport across the region, across the east of England. What is it that we need to do between now and 2050? Then develop and accelerate the region's transport investment pipeline. What technically do we need to do to really deliver against those regional priorities? We need to make sure we elevate in all the work of our partners to a national audience. So all the great work that our local authorities, our partners do, how does that get through to central government? We then need to influence all levels of government and delivery bodies like National Highways, Network Rail, to make sure that what they're proposing is also something that Transport East wants to take forward. And then fifth, inform an intelligence hub. So intelligence, data, analysis, making sure we have the transport insights for the region to really inform our decision-making going forward. Now, the team that we've created are all experts in their respective areas that can cover all of that. They've got years of experience in transport planning, communications, engagement, project and relationship management. But it's not just that core team. As I mentioned earlier, we're really supported by our senior officer group, so officers from across our member authorities and partners who bring a really diverse range of talents and valuable local knowledge to our partnership. And then our decision makers, so our Transport East Forum, they're our political leaders, our business representatives. They steer our work and undertake much of our advocacy and wider influencing. So it's really important that we see ourselves as not only that core team, but a wider team. So what does my role entail within that? I oversee the work of the partnership, coordinating it all with governments. We set this out in our business plan earlier in the year. This is available online for our listeners to look at. But basically, it sets out four work areas that I'm overseeing. Governance of Transport East, our future strategy, our investment planning and engagement. And it means working really closely with the Department for Transport and delivery bodies, Network Rail, National Highways. We need to make sure we collaborate with our regional partners and speak with that single voice on transport issues. Now, our day-to-day operations are funded by our local partners, so our local authorities, who collectively contribute to the running costs of Transport East. But the really good news and really encouraging is that we've used that to leverage extra funding from the DfT. So over the last 18 months, we've secured about an additional £1 million from the DfT to really help drive forward our work programme. And this allows us to really steam ahead with delivering our business plan, which we published earlier this year. Now, our priorities over the next 6 months are clear. We need to deliver a transport strategy for the East of England. We've spoken with Baroness Beer, who's the minister at DfT that oversees our work. She's clear she wants to see a transport Bible for the East of England. And what we're going to do going forward is produce that. We're going out to public consultation in November to really ask the public, what is it they want to see? Do they agree with our proposals? The overarching vision for that draft transport strategy is clear: a thriving economy for the East, fast, reliable, safe, and resilient transport infrastructure, driving forward a future of inclusive and sustainable growth for decades to come. And that's where decarbonisation comes in. It is the overarching pillar to our transport strategy. Our strategy is going to be formed around decarbonisation. It's one of four strategic priorities within the strategy. The other three: connecting growing towns and cities, energising rural and coastal communities, and unlocking our international gateways, make up the other three priorities, but all of them coming together to understand how we can decarbonise our transport network going forward. And that's why this podcast and the contents within it are so important to Transport East.
Wow, Andrew, thanks for that. What a remit, a team of four to deliver all of that. That's absolutely amazing. I wish you all the very best with what you're trying to do. So decarbonisation is a massive social challenge, to which the response of many of us may well be, well, where do I start? So where and how did Transport East make a start?
Yeah, so we decided to really break this down into some manageable chunks. And firstly, it's understanding the scale of the problem, the scale of the challenge in the East of England. There are two parts to this. Firstly, understanding what data and analysis do we have that sets the challenge. But just as importantly, what are the views and aspirations of our partners and the public? It's going to take human beings, our partners, to make this happen. And we need to make sure that we're bringing everyone along with the journey. So we kick this off by leading a report that we published last year, setting out our baseline understanding of transport carbon emissions in the East. And this was really stark. It indicated that transport created over 40% of the region's carbon emissions, so more than any other sector within the East of England. And this was also much higher than many other regions. The average across other regions in the UK was 28%. So transport is a larger proportion of the East's carbon emissions than most other regions. And that gives us a real challenge. Crucially, it also showed that 96% of those emissions come from road transport. And it also pointed out the reasons why. I'll come on to these later, but they include the significant car dependency in our region, where a lot of people live in rural locations, and also our international gateway role. A lot of freight comes through our region. We then set about exploring those issues in more depth through our partner workshops as we started to build the evidence base for our strategy. Now, those conversations identified decarbonising transport as one of the most important priorities for the East. And we heard this from a range of partners. We heard this from local authorities, many of whom have declared climate emergencies themselves and set themselves quite stringent targets. We heard it from industry leaders who are grappling with how they decarbonise ports, airports and other sectors, and also transport operators in terms of how they manage fleets and buses going forwards into the future to get those to net zero. But it wasn't just partners. We wanted to test the views of our residents in the East. We did a public survey. Over 600 people from across the East of England replied. The need to decarbonise came out really clear through the public engagement survey that we did. Now, we're really mindful that one of the voices that needs to be heard is young people, the next generation, essentially. They're going to be the leaders of 2050. They're going to be the users of the transport network over the next 20 to 30 years. And it'll be them that drive some of the changes that we need to see. We held a creative competition for young people and really astounded by the quality of their ideas. They came forward in poems, pictures and stories and really set out some quite inspiring ideas for how we might decarbonise our transport network using some of those ideas from the younger generation. But we didn't just look within our own region. We looked more widely across England for ideas and innovation. Now, there's a huge and increasing library of information at the national level on how to tackle transport emissions. Much of this is excellent. We reviewed this, including the Royal Town Planning Institute report, which sets out a pathway for decarbonisation, and also many of the parliamentary inquiries that have taken place over the last year or so, particularly the Public Accounts Committee review of net zero and how to get there. It's really showed that some of the key things you need to do is to tackle public opinion, to really make sure we're bringing the public along with us, and to have that strategic oversight role, making sure that there's coordination at a regional and a government level to really support our local authorities. We work closely with the other six regions in England and London as well. They're all tackling this problem, and we work with them. We speak and share information, ensure that there's a joined up approach. So our challenge now is how to apply this strategic thinking, this data, this best practice, this public and partner appetite for change, bringing everyone along with us. We're now completing some work with the Energy Systems Catapult, which is an organisation that's been set up to really lead some of the thinking around decarbonisation, to really understand the scale of the challenge and what the pathway might look like and how achievable net zero is by 2040, by 2050, etc. This work is starting to show the stark scale of the challenge. And it's not just shifting to clean fuel, although EVs are a large part of it. There's a range of other interventions that need to take place. And hopefully through this podcast, we'll be able to explain that in a bit more detail.
That's amazing, Andrew. I love that, asking the next generation for their ideas about the sort of transport system they'd like to be using in 2050. I think that's absolutely brilliant. And leveraging all that other expertise that's already out there as well, that's super stuff. You mentioned some of the decarbonisation challenges that are facing East Anglia. So can you tell us about some of those in a bit more detail? And also, crucially, how you plan to tackle them?
Yeah, definitely, Eddie. The challenges are stark, and we have to think about the unique nature of the East of England. It's why Transport East was set up, because we are unique. We do have a unique set of challenges, and our solution is going to be quite different to some of those other parts of England. At a central government level, the government have set out a transport decarbonisation plan that sets out an approach nationally. And what that national approach talks about is some of the things we'll need to take on board. So that's reducing the need to travel by either bringing jobs and services closer to people, or even digitally, so really enhancing the role of broadband, 5G, and other types of technology. Then change to more sustainable modes. So how can we support people doing public transport, walking and cycling, as well as quite a significant shift to alternative fuels. But interestingly for the East, the solutions that work in large urban areas, your Londons, your Manchesters, just won't work for our region. We have a large rural and coastal population. So 1 in 5 of our people live on the coast. 1 in 3 live in a rural community. And historically, these are more isolated and much harder to provide commercial public transport for. Half of our emissions come from rural areas, our data is showing. So we need to come up with solutions that are pretty different to some of the other thinking across England. But we also have 75 towns and cities without a dominant urban area. Our economy is really built on a web of road and rail connections across the region, leading to more dispersed and diverse movement patterns. So people travel in a way across the region where they want to access different towns and cities according to their different needs. We're very reliant on our road network. Rail connections are quite good towards London, but often poor in other directions, particularly east-west. And as I said earlier, over 96% of our emissions are on the road network. So really tackling that road and car dependency, and also our rural dependency is going to be a key challenge. And finally, adding to the mix, we're a gateway to the rest of the world. We've got 13 ports and 3 airports, including 2 of the recent government designated free ports. We're located close to the international shipping lanes to the rest of the world, just across the sea from Antwerp and Rotterdam. So that international gateway role is never going to change. In fact, we embrace it and we need to get the economic benefits from that. And it's absolutely vital. You know, half of the UK's shipping containers move through our region, along with through our regional ports, tons of grain, aggregates and agricultural products. So we're a crucial interchange for businesses across the UK with international markets and suppliers. But all of this leads to hundreds of lorries on our roads every day. And indeed, the analysis is showing that nearly half of our emissions are actually from freight. And when I saw that, I was quite surprised at how high that was. But it does go to show how important our gateway role is and the need to tackle decarbonisation in the context of continuing that important economic role. But we've got some great opportunities as well. You know, our region supplies 60% of the UK's offshore wind energy. And with Sizewell C plans and also notable potential for hydrogen production, one of the roles of our transport forum is to really make sure we're making the links between that energy production and the use of it in our future transport network. And they're really keen to see us get to a place where we produce much of the electricity and power we need to power our own transport network going forwards. So we're talking to the energy sector, including National Grid, Hydrogen East, some of these great organisations, to link up the development of transport and energy infrastructure. Our local enterprise partnerships, for example, have done some great work already in this area, which we're looking to build on. But it's also really important to make sure we're balancing decarbonisation against the range of other outcomes we want to achieve. Across the east of England, as our transport strategy is going to show, we have a range of social and economic challenges that we're also trying to tackle. So we want to ensure a high quality of life for our residents, improve accessibility to jobs, leisure and services, particularly for those that live in rural areas and coastal areas where access to those types of facilities is quite challenging sometimes. And also levelling up really is an issue for the east of England as well. And our economy, we need to keep supporting our growing economy. Got a £74 billion economy, a net contributor to the Exchequer. We need to make sure that we continue that contribution to economic growth. We've got real economic strengths in freight, agriculture, technology, energy, but making sure that we're really tackling things such as skills. So at the minute, 1 in 2 graduates leave the region. We really need to help people get to training and jobs. And all of these are really important outcomes that we need to marry decarbonisation to. It's not easy, but our transport strategy is going to have a really good go at doing that. So to answer your question, how are we tackling this, Eddie? There's, a range of things that we're going to be taking forward through our transport strategy. And the regional scale is really the ideal scale to tackle decarbonisation. It needs collaboration between many partners. And across the region, we have those range of partners. We need a shared ambition, which we're going to set out in the regional transport strategy. And we need to identify strategic solutions that all of us can buy into. And actually, most of the trips with the biggest impact on carbon emissions are those across multiple local authority areas. And even for us, that includes trips that reach the rest of the UK. So many of our freight trips, for example, start in Felixstowe or London Gateway Port, end up in the Midlands, in the north, in London, in Scotland. It's only at a partnership level that we can really tackle decarbonisation. So through our draft transport strategy, we're going to set a path to net zero. This is going to be out for public consultation next month. We're essentially going to promote a bespoke approach for our region, building on the fundamental principles that the DfT and others have set, but with a real East of England angle and take on it. We want to reduce the need to travel. We want to help our residents to reduce the number of long trips they need to take by helping them travel more locally or not at all. So this can be done in many ways, ensuring everyone has access to ultra-fast broadband, for example, ensuring new housing growth is in places where people can access public transport and making home working much easier. But we found from modelling and actually our experiences through the pandemic that maybe about 30% of jobs can be done from home. But that still leaves 7 in 10 people who will need to travel for work in our region. And that's really important that we continue to help those people to travel around. Home working is good, but it's not the answer for everyone. So what we also want to do is help mode shift. So really helping people to do more trips by passenger transport or by walking or cycling or other innovations such as lift sharing, for example. Now, this is perhaps a bit easier in our urban areas, but incredibly different in rural and coastal areas. We really need some solutions and new business models, things like rural public transport, like the Catch project in Suffolk, which is a programme that the Suffolk County Council and East Suffolk have set up that sets out a way for people to access local transport through their communities more sustainably and enable them to access key interchanges such as rail stations and key services. We need more of that type of innovative thinking. And it's not just people we're talking about, it's goods as well. We talked about freight. How do we get that freight onto rail where we can? This means unblocking train paths to the rest of the country. For example, places like Ely Junction and Hawley Junction, where there's major constraints on how much freight can get through. But if we can start to unlock that, we can shift more freight from rail onto the road, supporting decarbonisation. And then you get onto alternative fuels. So we're a region lagging behind in electric vehicle uptake. But government is going to ban new petrol and diesel car sales from 2030 onwards, and we really need to be ready for that. We need to make it much easier for people in the East to actually own an electric car. In the East, we've done some great things already. For example, we have the first electric vehicle charging station, GridServe, in Braintree. We need more of these types of innovation. And it's not just cars. Fleet vehicles, buses, trains and good vehicles. We're fortunate to have some extremely innovative businesses and organisations in the East. Hydrogen East, for example, is a group that's formed to lead the way on thinking about hydrogen potential. We really need to be embracing this as part of our transport strategy. But I think crucially, our strategy is also going to set out an investment program, including an assessment framework for new investment. So the criteria of how we decide what to invest in going forwards, how we advise government on what it is we need for the region, needs to include decarbonisation. And this will really help the region prioritise the new projects we need to make that transition. And we're going to be championing that with government for funding and finding ways to unblock delivery. Now, I just want to focus on a couple of these pieces of work that we've gone into a bit more detail with. So we've investigated opportunities for active travel and buses. We've produced some bespoke reports on how we might tackle this. We really needed to enhance our regional understanding of what needs to happen to deliver that really substantial shift to sustainable modes. Now, both of these reports we've done over the last 6 months and have given us a set of recommendations to now take forward with partners. So for active travel, for example, we're aligned with the government's ambitions set out in Gear Change document. This is their document set out how they want to double walking and cycling across England, for example. The challenge for us in the East is that was very much predicated towards urban areas, but for rural areas such as ours and some of our market towns and growing towns and cities, what does active travel look like? We have lower density populations, a slightly older demographic, and longer average journeys in urban areas. We're starting to point towards solutions such as e-bikes, better integration with the public transport network, and building on some of the industries that we have, for example, our tourism network. We have millions of people coming to the East each year. How do we use that as an opportunity to get more people involved in active travel? And there's some great opportunities and exciting innovations across the region. Norwich, Suffolk, Essex, Thurrock, Southend, all are really racing this agenda. I think it's worth setting out the unique role of subnational transport bodies, but just before I finish my answer here. There's projects which are best progressed at a pan-regional level, but there's also those that are best progressed at a national level and really working across the country. So we are working with our neighbouring subnational transport bodies, England's Economic Heartland, Transport for the South East, and other bodies across the entirety of England to really scope areas of work which is going to drive us forward. This is things such as electric vehicle infrastructure, linked to that regional energy infrastructure plans. And we're also really concerned about rural transport. Over half of our emissions are from rural areas, as I talked about earlier. So Transport East has taken the lead in England across the 7 English STBs. We've set out a work programme that we're leading the country on, creating a case for investment in rural transport, setting out best practice guidance, and then advising government on how rural outcomes could be prioritised by government, making its way into things such as government and treasury appraisal to make sure that at that government level, we really care about transport outcomes in rural areas. For a region like East to be successful in tackling decarbonisation, there does need to be different approaches at national, local and regional level. And we really want to push things such as reducing the complexity of funding, longer term funding certainty from government, changing appraisal to greater value decarbonisation and other outcomes. And it's this complex package of measures, Eddie, I think, that we're trying to bring together to really drive forward decarbonisation in the east of England.
An incredible package of work and activity going on already, Andrew, in the course of 18 months. I salute you. And as a rural east of England car driver that's still kicking around in a fossil fuel car, I look forward to some of these innovations coming forward and helping me to make that transition to decarbonisation. And of course, you mentioned you're working with a lot of different partners, the ports, National Rail, Highways England, etc. You come up against situations where they have potentially competing priorities. I just wondered how Transport East manages that complex web of relationships.
Yeah, it's a great question and fundamental to what we do. As a regional partnership, our relationships are crucial to our success. We're basically rooted within the partners. The agile nature of the team that we've set up allows us to do this. We need to be incredibly close to all of our partners. And the way we've set ourselves up, hopefully, will enable us to manage those relationships, but really drive us forward. So from the beginning, we've taken a very collaborative approach to developing and delivering our work, particularly the development of the draft transport strategy. And we can't be an effective single voice without it. And government have been very clear. They want to see the East coming forward, not as a set of disparate voices, but a single voice. This is what we want collectively. It makes it much easier for them to agree with that and to then fund it going forwards. We've put in place resource to focus on that engagement. It doesn't happen by accident. So the first appointment we made was Esme Yule, who's our communications lead. She's incredibly experienced. She has a fantastic background in partnerships and engagement, and she has been driving forward our work programme and communications plan. We've spoken to hundreds of people in developing the draft transport strategy and our priority investment pipeline, That's through workshops, our annual summit, regular meetings, one-to-one conversations, and many other types of forum. We really need to make sure we can speak confidently with a single voice for the region, and it's only by doing that activity that we can do so. Should say that we're supported by an expert group of officers from our local authorities and wider partners, and we really rely on their knowledge to make sure that our work reflects the needs and ambitions of our partners. So they're absolutely fundamental to our work. I mean, one of our roles is also to influence both national government and across the region, and we can't do that if we're not a trusted partner. I think it's also vital that we have clarity, accountability, transparency, and a strong governance in place to underpin all of that. So our transport forum meetings are held quarterly. The papers are published a week before. They're publicly available. They're online. And that forum is composed of leaders across all sectors. So local transport authorities, districts, chambers of commerce, local enterprise partnerships, DfT, Network Rail, neighbouring authorities, National Highways, the UK Innovation Corridor. There's a wide range of partners on that decision-making forum. It has a really clear terms of reference which sets out how we work. And the work programme is agreed by the forum and the government in our business plan. And our business plan is our public statement of what we're going to do. We also have a wider partnership panel. So these are about 100 other partners across the region that we work with, we have regular conversations with. And we also have very close relationships with our MPs. So, for example, underneath all this activity, we held the Transport East Summit earlier this year. Over 150 regional partners joined us. Transport Minister Baroness Beer was our keynote speaker, and we had a range of other speakers on the range of topics around transport strategy. It was a big success, and part of that was workshops to really make sure we were on the right track in terms of that single voice. I mentioned we work closely with our MPs. Dr. Dan Poulter MP is our parliamentary ambassador. We work with him and our other MPs to ensure our views are represented in Westminster and government. Even, for example, tomorrow, we're co-hosting a parliamentary reception in the House of Commons with the East of England All-Party Parliamentary Group to really make sure that our MPs and regional leaders are really behind our core messaging. We really want to elevate the work of our partners and bring them together within our forthcoming transport strategy. And the other way to get buy-in is through public consultation. Indeed, that's what we're doing in November. So the public consultation in November is going to be a big opportunity, not only for our partners, but the public, to understand what's in our draft transport strategy, comment on it, and hopefully get behind it. And once we have that in place towards the end of the financial year, that will be our single voice, our clear vision, and how we're going to deliver it. And hopefully through all of that activity, we address the challenges of how do you get that single voice, and we take everyone on the same journey with us.
Terrific stuff, Andrew. And as a Suffolk resident and therefore one of your stakeholders at Transport East on that side, you've given me a great deal of confidence that the work you're doing is robust, it's well organised, and is involving as many people as possible in getting the right possible outcome. So I look forward to my opportunity to take part in the public consultation later in the year. We're obviously delighted that Transport East chose to use Crown Commercial Service Framework to procure some expert consultancy at the outset of your decarbonisation. Can I ask you what made you choose CCS and also how did that work out for you?
Yeah, it's a great question. I think it goes back to some of my earlier comments about the fact we're a small team. We're working to very ambitious timescales for commissioning and delivering our work. And the fact that our technical work is funded by DfT, they need us to use that funding effectively. They want value for money. They want robust procurement. They've given us, you know, £500,000 last year, the same this year. We're asking them for further funding going forwards. We have very short timescales to utilise that money effectively. So we were looking for solutions going forward. And this is going to be the nature of much of our funding. And indeed, it is for local authorities, you know, and many other partners at the minute. How do you utilise that funding effectively to get the outcomes you want using a really robust process? We're kindly hosted by Suffolk County Council, and we've lent on their procurement team to support our commissioning activity. And it was through conversations with them and yourself, Eddie, and a number of other partners that led us to the Crown Commercial Service. So the Crown Commercial Service frameworks really allow us to cut through some of the bureaucracy around procurement. I think your qualification processes are robust, transparent, which means we can trust the suppliers identified on the framework. And really making sure that they're capable of actually undertaking this work, which we have to get right first time, and we don't have a lot of time to do it. I think we also really appreciate the visible support provided. Those conversations with yourself, Eddie, and your colleagues really explained the process and gave us confidence that it was a process that we could use. It also gave confidence to DFT and our regional partners that we're using that grant responsibly and the processes can really stand up to scrutiny. I think it also meant that the assessment and contracting process is more manageable and de-risked, an approach that all suppliers on the framework understand the standardized terms and conditions. We didn't have to reinvent the wheel at all. It was all there ready to use. And this really sped up the process of commissioning work, meaning we can get on with delivery faster. And I think if you look back to the results over the first year of that, it's been justified. The approach has been a good one. The contracts that we've used through Crown Commercial Service have been effective with good outcomes. We've delivered the technical evidence base for the transport strategy on time. It's of a high quality. We're now on track to deliver the consultation on the transport strategy itself and get that to the Secretary of State. And I think, Eddie, it's the processes that have been put in place, it's the confidence that we have in the Crown Commercial Service has allowed that procurement to take place with little risk, allowed us to do it quickly. And the results are now bearing that fruit. So from our experience, it's been a very good one. And I think we'd look to use it in the future.
Thanks, Andrew. That's a great story of successful procurement. And we're really pleased to have been a part of that and to have helped Transport East get up and running and tackle this huge challenge that is ahead of you. Just before we close, Andrew, I'd like to perhaps get a more personal view, if I may. Some parting thoughts from you on the big changes that we're likely to see in the transport system in the UK as we head towards decarbonisation. What's going to look different for us in, say, 5 years' time, 10 years' time, and so on? Some reflections on that before we close, Andrew, please.
Yeah, it's a great question. And one that Transport East, as a thought leader, that we're really grappling with at the minute through our transport strategy work. In some respects, some elements of the world of transport haven't traditionally changed very quickly. But what we've seen through the COVID-19 pandemic has changed all of that. People can adapt to new ways of working and traveling quickly. There's almost been a paradigm shift in the way that people think about transport over the last 18 months or so. And there's a real urgency of acting now, particularly through decarbonisation, to transform for the future. A lot of emphasis is placed on new technologies, greening is existing travel. But I think what we've seen is changing fuels won't deliver the emission reduction needed totally. And it won't also bring the whole myriad of other social benefits that come along with increased walking, cycling, and use of public transport. If you look back 10 years and think what have been the big shifts in transport, they actually haven't been all about transport at all. Online shopping has added millions of van trips to our streets. Remote working has shifted our commutes. And this is guiding our thinking going forward. So there needs to be much greater focus on people, ultimately our customers in the east of England, giving them more options to do what they want. We know through our survey with the public early this year that many are willing to travel less, but they still value, when they do travel, reliability, frequency, reduced costs, reduced travel time. And so we need to make sure that we're tackling those challenges that real people face in the east of England. I think if we're successful in our vision for the East of England, then in 10 years, there'll be less private car trips, more bus and rail journeys. If you live in a rural area, for example, you'll be able to call a minibus from your phone to pick you up at the nearest station or use your app, for example. In town, there'll be full networks, connected networks, safe networks of things such as high-quality cycle routes. People will easily be able to hop between bus, train, bike hire, paying for it all through the same system, making it much easier for that customer to be able to access transport and sustainable transport. Between towns, we'll see low carbon rapid transit schemes linking large centres with their hinterlands and large market towns. Electric cars will be the norm, along with hydrogen buses and lorries. So really decarbonising that transport fleet. Now, the nature of car ownership might also change. I mentioned young people earlier on. We spoke to the Youth Parliament through our early engagement. They told us they don't necessarily want to own a car. They just value the freedom that it provides. So how can you provide that freedom through different mechanisms, different forms of car ownership, for example, different forms of passenger transport, really supporting young people with different models of accessibility. I think as a nation as well, we've also got to look at the future of our major road network, how we use them and how we continue to pay for essential transport investment in the absence of fuel duty. In 2030, when new petrol and diesel car sales are banned, How is tax for roads going to be raised? This is a major issue that I think nationally we need to tackle, and the East needs to be at the forefront of that agenda. I think without managing demand, though, there's a serious risk that more cars end up using our roads as EVs become cheaper to buy and run. And so we've also got to look at the options for increased car sharing, whether formally through EV car clubs or encouraging people to share their regular journeys. It's not just about the technical aspects of the transport system. Our focus needs to be on what people actually need to make a zero carbon option the first choice for the many different types of journey that they make from the door to door. So integrating customer information and payment options is really essential to that. And I think the complexity of the transport network in the east of England, outside of London, is a real barrier to that. And so some of those background systems are going to be fundamental going forwards, and we really need to see a shift in the provision of that to our customers. I think there needs to be other things looked at. So the safety and security of our transport networks is fundamental. So major incidents on the road network to things such as personal harassment, personal safety. We really have to make the systems actually both feel safer and actually be safer. We're very interested by the proposals across a lot of the UK for Vision Zero. That is that it is not acceptable for anyone to leave their home at the start of the day and not return at the end of the day, having used the transport network. And we really need to work with the police and many other partners to make sure that becomes a reality. And we also have to make sure our transport become more accessible to everyone. There's no point in having a great service if you can't actually get on the train or along the street to the bus stop. So making sure we're including all members of society. And I think we need to focus on what transport allows people to do and be. We want to make it easier to access further education and training, easier to secure a skilled, well-paid job, easier to be active in day-to-day lives for longer, easier to access essential services and really enjoy various hobbies and leisure activities. So really focusing on the people aspect and what it allows us to do. I think transport has to help break down barriers, actually than be a barrier in itself. So how do we help people do all of these things, but particularly through net zero decarbonisation? I think, Eddie, that is the challenge. You need to achieve all of these outcomes, yet remain on that path to decarbonisation. It's going to be a really interesting future, but one I think that Transport East and its partners will be at the forefront of.
Well, thank you for that, Andrew. Really fascinating and interesting reflections, not just in that last session, but across the whole of the podcast today. And I'm sure that anyone listening today will have found that what you've had to say really insightful. And I'm sure they'll have taken something away of value from today's podcast. Certainly, I've taken away as an East of England resident an awful lot to think about my own personal choices in relation to transport, but the choices that I make in pursuing those things you just talked about, accessing essential services and so forth. So really fantastic food for thought. Can I just thank you really wholeheartedly for giving up your time today to talk to us? Just before I close, any final thoughts or comments?
Any listeners here listen to this podcast, very welcome to get in touch with Transport East to help us on our journey. I think, as I've emphasised, relationships is fundamental. So developing that partnership and relationships with anyone across England who shares our agenda would be very welcomed. But thank you very much as well, Eddie, for the opportunity to be on this podcast. Really enjoyed it and look forward to working with CCS going forward as well.
Thank you very much, Andrew. Much appreciated. To find out more about the work of Transport East, by all means, visit their website, transporteast.org.uk. You'll find contact details there for Andrew and his team if you want to take him up on his offer and get in touch and contribute to the excellent work that they're doing. So thank you very much for listening in today. To learn more about how CCS can help you on your carbon net zero journey, please visit crowncommercial.gov.uk/CNZ. Thanks once again for listening in. I hope that you found today's session as informative and enjoyable as I have. Goodbye, thanks, and have a great day.